For those of you who haven't met, my name is Andreia, and I'm a PhD student at the London School of Hygiene and Clinical Medicine. And the work I'm going to present now has been conducted as part of my PhD with the help of my supervisor Sarah Thomas and Andrews. So for this presentation, I'll start with the definition of near real-time surveillance. Then I'll explain some of the existing methods to perform this kind of surveillance. I'll introduce you to the clinical practice research data link, which is the database, the electronic health records that I'm using as part of my PhD. And then I'll go through some of the steps I'm taking towards the implementation of near real-time surveillance using these data and some preliminary data on the system implementation. So this is ongoing work. I don't have like final answers yet, but I'll show you basically the steps I'm undertaking, and I'll finish with the summary. So we've seen that there's a need to quickly identify signals in post-licensure surveillance so we can take appropriate measures. This is particularly relevant for some vaccines where we have a really short action time, like for seasonal influenza vaccines, we only have the season. So if we identify a signal by the end of the season, there's not really a point because there's nothing we can do about it. So near real-time vaccine safety surveillance arose as a method to timely identify these signals. And the main difference of this approach with other methods is that we start shortly after a new vaccine has been introduced, and we will look at data at regular points in time. So instead of having a big epidemiological study conducted at one point in time, we look at regular points in time, let's say every week, every month, for example. And the basis of this approach are sequential tests that are widely used in industry, but also in clinical trials. So this is a slide I've shown you before, but basically this is how it looks like. We have a critical limit, and then we plot a quantity that we compare against this critical limit, and we look at this data, in this case every week, and if the quantity surpasses the critical limit, we raise a signal that needs to be confirmed. So this activity has been described as part of the signal identification, but some authors have called it signal strengthening because it's used for suspected adverse events, and then we still need to confirm any signals identified from here. The tests that we used are sequential tests, and the basis come from Wald's sequential probability ratio test that was first proposed in the 40s. And this has been used in industry for many, many years, but in the context of vaccine surveillance in post-licensure, it has only been proposed in 2005. So this test, the basis, basically works in a similar way to what I've shown you before, but it has two limits. So if we plot this log likelihood ratio against these two limits, and if it falls in the middle, we continue surveillance. If it surpasses the upper limit, we reject the null hypothesis. There is no increased risk. And if it goes below the lower limit, we do not reject null hypothesis and we end surveillance. So this test is available in a binomial and a Poisson using these two distributions, but it was shown also around 2005 that there were some issues with the use of these tests for vaccine safety surveillance, namely in the specification of the null hypothesis. So Martin Koldorf and his colleagues in the US developed a maximized version of these tests where there is a composite hypothesis. So we test, there's either an increase of the probability of experiencing the event or in the relative risk, and basically it looks very similar with the difference that we only have a limit, and if this quantity that we calculate every week or every month falls below that limit, we continue surveillance. If it surpasses, we raise a signal. So we know that these methods have been used in some places, but they haven't been fully applied in the UK. And there are a lot of electronic health records in the UK, such as the Clinical Practice Research Data Link. So the rationale for my PhD was, knowing all these, can we actually use CPRD to perform near real-time vaccine safety surveillance? So bearing that in mind, I have three main research aims. One was the first one that is already completed, was to identify the methods that have been used to perform near real-time vaccine safety surveillance, then assess the feasibility of implementing these methods using CPRD, and finally mimic a system using historical data. So these two are pretty much completed. This, which you'll probably find the most interesting one, is the one that I'm working on at the moment. So to identify the existing methods, I've conducted a systematic review that has now been published in Pharmacoepidemiology and Drug Safety, and I'll show you the study and the main results. So to identify these studies, as I've mentioned, I conducted a systematic review, and I've tried to identify initially published studies using MBase, Medline, Web of Science, and looking at abstract books of selected conference. But I've also tried, and given the novelty of these methods, we thought it was really important to identify unpublished studies. So I've contacted several vaccine safety experts trying to ascertain further studies. To be eligible for the systematic reviews, the studies should have used routinely collected health data, study pre-specified outcomes, and regularly look for an excess in the observed number of events, because this is the distinctive feature of near real-time vaccine safety surveillance. And we've excluded those studies that only base their analysis on spontaneous reporting systems that were aimed at testing hypotheses or that were just trying to develop new methods. So in this search, I've identified and screened over 2,000 results, and finally included 31 studies. And this is the timeline that I've shown you before that summarizes all the studies that I've included. Of course, there's a lot of information here, but there are three main points that I'd like to emphasize. The first one is that the studies using these methods have increased throughout time. So it started in 2005 in VSD, Vaccine Safety Data Link, in the US, and there's been an increased interest not only in the US but also in other countries. The vaccines that have been assessed using these methods were mainly influenza vaccines, but there also an interest in 2009-10 because of the pandemic influenza vaccine. And finally, we have in colors the group of methods that were used in each study. So in blue, we have continuous sequential tests that I'll explain in a few minutes what they are. In orange, group sequential, and in green, statistical process control. So you'll see that we have more blue. So basically, continuous tests have been used more often. And as I mentioned, there was a lot of interest, mainly in the US, where these tests were initially developed and have been used. And now they are actually routinely used by Vaccine Safety Data Link. As for the vaccines, influenza in general, both seasonal and pandemic influenza have been assessed using these methods. And now I have here all the available methods summarized. So in this slide, I have the first group, continuous sequential. Continuous sequential methods are allow us to look at data as often as desired. So every time we receive new data, we can look and conduct a test. And then within continuous sequential, so this overall group of studies, we have several different specific statistical tests. There's SPRT, which is the initial ones that were used at the very beginning, but then they've been stopped due to these issues I referred with the specification of the null hypothesis. Then there is the Poisson maximized version of SPRT, which has been used more often. It's simple to implement, but it requires, it basically compares an expected, an observed to an expected number of events, and it does require accurate data on the expected level needed. I won't really go into all the details of the characteristics of the studies, but if someone has a particular interest, we can discuss at the end. So, as I mentioned, the Poisson-based version has been most often used, but the binomial version of this test has also been used in quite a number of studies, and it compares the two different groups instead of comparing an observed to an expected ratio. So it offers some advantages over the Poisson, but it's more complex. And then we have this conditional version that requires less certainty on the historical data compared to the Poisson. So it was developed as an extension of the Poisson-based version. So these are the continuous sequential, the ones that we can look at data as often as desired. And then we have two other groups, the group sequential and statistical process control. So the group sequential only looks at, we only look at data at discrete points in time. And the choice of which one to use really depends on the data we have. So if we can have data like every time, or almost every time, like in the VSD, they use weekly surveillance, so it's fine to use the continuous. But if you only get data every month or every 3 months, for example, the group sequential might be a better approach. So the main advantage is that it requires less frequent updates. Then the statistical process control is a simplified approach where you just plot the number of events against the mean plus a certain number of standard deviations based on historical data. But the main issue is that we have no way of accounting for, or formally accounting for multiple testing, which is the main issue from a statistical point of view if you are to conduct repeated analysis throughout time. So the other sequential tests do formally account for multiple testing, and statistical process control doesn't. So apart from the tests, there were other issues identified from the systematic review, namely the how these studies handled confounding or potential confounders. And in general, they've adjusted the expected rates. They've used adjusted expected rates. Some studies also use stratification or self-control design. Another really relevant issue are the delays in the data. So this is this sort of a surveillance is ended in real time or near real time. But we always have some delays in receiving the data. And in general, studies have just delayed their analysis, but others have started to develop ways of adjusting for expected delays. And that is important if we want to avoid some bias in the analysis. As I've already mentioned, there were some signals identified from these analyses, and some of them were actually turned out to be false positives. So it's important to decide beforehand how we were going to handle this. So just to summarize the main findings, we've seen that there's been an increased interest in these methods, particularly in the US, and they've been used for influenza vaccines. And when it comes to the methods, we can start by seeing which overall group of methods is a better fit for our data, and then select a specific test. There's a limited strategies to account for confounders, and we need timely data and a strategy on how to handle false positives.
Can I ask about the false positives? How did you know they were false positive signals?
They weren't confirmed.
So they're not actually false positives. They haven't been confirmed to be true positives, but you don't actually know if they're false.
Yeah. So if you want, you can never totally exclude them.
Yeah.
But so maybe to be more accurate, they weren't confirmed with
right.
further studies.
So it's absence of evidence as opposed to evidence of absence.
Yes. Well, yeah. Three of these 11 were actually confirmed in further studies.
Yeah.
So if there's a signal coming from these analyses, after. There are a lot of different strategies, but usually there's an epidemiological and more rigorous, with a more rigorous design conducted to see if the signal is confirmed or not. So yeah, there's like evidence to sustain that the other nine signals were actually true signals. So are there any other questions? And feel free to interrupt me because, of course, there's a lot of information, and I know probably some of you will not be familiar with some of the concepts, especially now that I'll enter into the electronic health.
If you're going on, can I ask you about your sequential analysis? How do you get the controls?
So, it depends on the tests we use, but if we use a Poisson test, we compare, for example, let's say in influenza vaccines, we compare the study season with data from historical seasons. So it's an observed versus expected rate.
Based on historic data?
Yeah.
Okay.
But you can also use concurrent controls or a self-controlled design where you compare those who got the event after they've been vaccinated to those who got the event before they've been vaccinated, for example.
You're looking at a sequential study, though, that has contemporary controls, aren't you?
Yes. In those
cases. So how do you collect those controls?
So in this case, if you use a self-controlled design, you only have information, only analyze information from cases.
So it's all self-control, not concurrent cases that you've collected.
Became more often to use the self-controlled approach.
It's certainly a lot easier from my experience in the past.
Yeah, and that's probably one of the reasons why most studies use a self-control.
And how do you position the control periods? Do you set them after your risk periods or
so
before
exposure? I've heard that question being asked to a lot of people using self-control case series. So it's based on your knowledge, but you're not 100% sure that's the right period. So it's based on your knowledge, and then what some people do is to conduct a sensitivity analysis. For example, for Guillain-Barré syndrome, usually the risk window is 42 days, and then some consider 21 as a sensitivity analysis. But there isn't like a rule on as to define what's the better comparison in terms of periods. At least there are no rules.
Can I just pursue that?
Yes.
If you're looking at Guillain-Barré syndrome, there's a period of a flu-like illness that precedes Guillain-Barré syndrome. It is a flu, a virus illness usually, for the wild cases. So how do you take care of that?
Do you
have good enough data in these healthcare databases to be able to pick up those cases, which are really quite important?
So you can't really distinguish, at least with the data that I'm analyzing. I'll go into more detail in the sort of data we have, and perhaps we can then discuss that further. But yeah, we don't have that deep level of detail, I'd say. So we've seen the existing methods, and bearing this in mind, the idea was then to progress to the data we have available. So I'll explain to you which sort of data is and what data we have there, and then how we plan the implementation of these methods. So we know that near real-time methods require rapid accrual of data, so when considering whether a data source, electronic health records, can actually be used to implement these methods, we think that there are four main characteristics that they should meet, namely being population-based, being timely enough, having appropriate size, and have good validity for the exposure, in this case the vaccine, and for the outcome. And in the case of the data we have, which is CPID, the Clinical Practice Research Database, this is a primary care database. It had by mid-2013 over 4 million active patients, contributing data for the database. And it has information on diagnosis, vaccines administered in primary care, referrals and feedback from secondary care. And it can also include linkages with hospital and mortality data. And it is an evolving data set in the sense that they are expanding and having new practices with new patients and more patients coming in. So the idea was to see whether CPRD actually met these characteristics. So we know from previous studies that CPRD is representative from the UK population, so with a priori considered to be population-based. So then I've started evaluating whether it met the other characteristics. So just to give you a sense of how we actually analyze this data, I'm going to explain you key dates we have for every single of these patients. So basically what happens with CPRD is a person goes to see his or her GP, and then their GP enters some information on the computer. And they can enter either free text, which we don't have access to, or code the diagnosis. And in case of the UK, they use the read codes system. And then the practices that contribute to CPRD at some time upload that data to a central, to CPRD, which is based at MHRA. And every month, researchers have access to new data, which the practices, each practice has uploaded at some point previous to that point in time. And in CPRD, each practice and patients will have key information. So we'll have this up to standard date, which is a date that CPRD considers that a given practice is of enough research quality. Then we have the current registration date, which is the time at which the patient has joined a specific practice. And if we are interested in conducting a study, there will be a time at which the study begins. So for a given patient, that we start considering data from a patient at the latest of these 3 days. Conversely, we will end the follow-up time, if we here follow-up time, not necessarily in terms of being a cohort, but the time that this patient will have data for us to analyze. So this will end at the earliest of these dates, and this will be the time at which the study ends, or the time at which we stop having data from this patient. And this can either be when the patient transfers out of practice because he moved to another practice or because he died, or the last collection date, so the last time the practice uploaded information. So this is the time worth of data that we can have for these specific patients. And then, if there is an event of interest recorded, in this case coded using the read code system, we have two key dates. So we have the event date, which is considered as being the time at which the event has happened. But because we can record that information retrospectively, there's the system date, which is the time at which the information was entered into the system. And this is automatically assigned by the software. So knowing this, I've started with those outcomes that had been studied in previous studies, so the ones I've identified from the systematic review, and I selected those that had been evaluated more than 3 times and started assessing key characteristics based on those that we thought that were really key to implement a near real-time system. And these were both the validity and data accrual process. How timely was the data that we got from CPRD? And then for these two, I've used, for validity, I used previously published studies, while for data accrual process, I've classified factors, like the condition, according to factors that could affect the way data accrues into CPRD. But then I've also looked into more detail for 4 selected outcomes. And then if the outcome was considered to be feasible for these 2 characteristics, I went to evaluate it in further detail. So these were the outcomes that were evaluated more than 3 times in the study. So those that I consider to be of particular relevance for near real-time vaccine safety. And so for each one of these, I've collected information on the validity of the outcome in CPRD. So how good was CPRD in recording that information for those outcomes? And then, as I've mentioned, I classified according to onset and place of diagnosis, trying to capture how delayed these data could be in CPRD. And based on these, I selected 4 outcomes for a more detailed evaluation of delays. And these were selected both because they had, we've considered them to have quite good validity, but also because they represented different types of outcomes that could be recorded in different way in CPRD. And these were Bell's palsy, a particular example of the melanin disease, optic neuritis, Guillain-Barré syndrome, and seizures.
Yes. So if you looked at the positive predictor value, which essentially says if it's coded, how likely is it that it is in fact this diagnosis? Did you also look at the sensitivity? I mean,
so
if there was an event in the patient, how likely are you to actually capture it in the primary care data?
I haven't looked at myself, so this is only based on the literature. But I focus more on PPD.
Yeah.
But there are also some studies on sensitivity. I mean, most studies report both.
I think this is a major challenge with the patient record system. Is if you don't capture the events, you're not going to be able to find the signals, right?
That's an issue. And that is actually related with the power we have to detect. And I've actually connected myself some analysis of completeness comparing with hospitals. I'll show you that. So considering these characteristics, the outcomes were selected, and I've evaluated recording the delays in more detail, and the manuscript is now under review. So when it comes to recording delays, there are several reasons as to why we get a delay in receiving the data. So there can be just because there's a delay in making the diagnosis. So you see a GP with a certain symptoms, but sometimes you require like additional exams or being seen by a consultant elsewhere. So that might be a delay because of that. And it's actually quite hard to capture that. Then there's, because this is a primary care database and GPs will not make all the diagnoses, some will be made at the hospital. In principle, GPs should receive feedback from the hospital, but there will be a certain delay in receiving this feedback. So this is actually the sort of delay I've assessed in this specific work. And then there are delays due to processing the data and uploading it, then both to CPRD and then for us as researchers. So as I mentioned, we selected outcomes that could have different delays, and those that have an acute onset in principle should be recorded more quicker than those that have an insidious onset, because usually those outcomes are just require more time to have a definitive diagnosis, but also in terms of place of diagnosis. So those conditions that are generally diagnosed and managed by GPs will come in quicker than those handled in the hospital. So in addition to this analysis of delays, I've also compared data with HAS. So this is our hospital database, and we can actually get linked data. So the objectives for this specific piece of work were to examine recording delays due to delays in receiving and recording information from other levels of care, and also evaluate completeness of recording diagnosis in CPRD. So as I mentioned, we selected different outcomes, and here Guillain-Barré syndrome was used as an example of an acute condition diagnosed mainly in hospitals. Then Bell's and other acute conditions, but typically diagnosed and managed by GPs. Optic neuritis, which is an insidious condition, and febrile seizures, which is acute and can be managed in both settings or just not receive any medical attention at all. And how did I actually compare, assess delays? So the analysis just using CPRD data. And this is the reason why it's important for you to understand how these dates work. As I've mentioned, we have an event date, which is considered the date to be the date at which the event, the outcome has happened, and then a system date. So we compared, and initially we thought that we could just compare the system and the event date, and that would give us a measure of delays. However, we realize that system dates can be changed if there are mass transfers of records due to the software being updated, for example, or when a patient transfers from a previous practice. And if I used system dates that have been changed to a later date, then this would lead to an overestimation of delays. So first, before this analysis of delays, there was a need to identify these transfers because there wasn't information in the system to tell us, look, these dates have been changed at some point in time. So looking at all the records from the patients, I've developed an approach comparing records with a certain number of system dates, assuming that if there were many, many system dates on one day, that's really, really unlikely to happen. And based on that assumption and some further assumptions, I've developed a measure to try to identify these system dates. I'm not going into detail, but just for you to bear in mind that this was one of the first challenges that I faced while trying to assess delays in CCAD. And for the actual analysis, then, this is basically summarizing what we have. So you have the system date, and then compare just the two. If, in addition to exclude patients involved in mass transfers or records likely to have been involved in mass transfers, I've also decided to exclude delays over a year, because those records would not be really useful for surveillance purposes, especially if this is meant to be done in near real time. It's like too much of a delay. And also, these are, we thought of them as odd reporting behavior, and so those were excluded. And then to describe delays, a generally cumulative distribution of delays. And then for the analysis using hospital NCPRD link data, for each outcome, I've created a cohort of patients that have been first diagnosed in hospitals and followed them up until they had a diagnosis reported in CPRD. And for the analysis, I've used Kaplan-Meier, which allow us to look well at delays and completeness. So this comes back to the issue of validity of records. Like, can we actually capture all the diagnoses? Are the diagnoses what, just because we have a code of Guillain-Barré syndrome, is that actually a Guillain-Barré syndrome or not? So those are the issues we face when we try to use electronic health records to perform research. So this is the graph for mass transfers, just for you to get an idea. We've identified records that had up to 3,000 other records on the same system date, so this was really likely to be a mass transfers. And then we needed to select like a cutoff to exclude those that were likely to be mass transfers. Of course, it isn't possible to have like a cutoff that will only exclude those that were involved in mass transfers, but we decided for 100. So all the records that had 100 or more other records on the same system date were excluded. And here, there are the main results for the standalone CPRD. So this is the cumulative distribution of delays for the four outcomes, Guillain-Barré syndrome, Bell's palsy, optic neuritis, and seizures. And as you can see, the pattern at which data accrues is quite different depending on the condition. So Bell's palsy accrues quicker as we expected, because it's usually managed by GPs, while optic neuritis and Guillain-Barré syndrome takes longer to accrue. But still, and this is in weeks, over a year, most records accrue within the first month. And this is a Kaplan-Meier for the linked data. And we've seen that this is also over a year. And at the end of the first year, after the diagnosis in hospital, we have quite low completeness in CPRD. So the highest is achieved for seizures, but also for Guillain-Barré syndrome, but it's still below 50%. And for the other two conditions, it's around 20%. But in fact, for example, for Bell's palsy, we didn't really expect a high value, but for Guillain-Barré syndrome, it was quite surprising to see that such a low number of cases from hospital were reported in the CPRD.
Why did you not expect a high proportion for those positive?
Because so it doesn't really necessarily require follow-up, and so we didn't necessarily expect them to know about Bell's palsy. While from Guillain-Barré syndrome, it can leave some sequela, and it's potentially a serious condition, so and requires further follow-up, so we thought that it should really be captured by GPs. But for the purpose of near real-time surveillance, it's not necessarily an issue in terms of the validity, because if this recording pattern is constant over time, and we are using historical data for the comparison, then our analysis will not be biased. But we will have less power.
You will be delayed, that's the big problem. You will be late to find the signals. If you only get one out of five.
Yeah, sure. But in terms of delays, we get most of them still within like 10 weeks from the hospital. And overall, the records accrue quite quickly.
But you're saying it's you only get 20% of the diagnosis, so you're getting one out of the five Bell palsies. The other ones you're not seeing at all.
No, but Bell palsies is mainly diagnosed in GPs. So here, when we say it's 20% of those diagnosed in hospitals, it's not 20% of all of them.
Yeah. So do you have those figures to say, I mean, how many are missing altogether? Did you get a look at those figures?
No, so you can't really, I can from this analysis know how many are missing overall. But in terms of Bell's palsy, we should capture most of them from the GP data itself, because most diagnoses are done in primary care.
Yeah, I get that. I think that it would be interesting to see how many you do, because you look at the numbers you have in the hospital data and the numbers you have in the CPRD and compare those numbers. That would be an interesting comparison.
Oh, the other way around.
Yeah, well, to see them side by side.
I also have that, but for this particular analysis, I consider that I was not really interested in knowing how many would get into the hospital data, because I will only have, for near real-time surveillance, only CPRD will be available.
Yeah.
So I'm more interested in those that I'll be missing.
Yeah, yeah, no. I think it's interesting just to know, out of all the ones that happen across the two systems, how many, like you say, if most of the diagnosis of Bell's palsy are happening in the primary care, you'll have most of them, even if you miss 4 out of 5 from the hospital. But it'll be interesting to see that figure, just to know
how many are capturing. I did do more evaluations, but I don't have them with me at the moment. But yeah, definitely. So, but for the real-time surveillance, the issue will be more in terms of power. So we don't necessarily need to capture all of that. But the more we capture, the more power we will have.
And the quicker you will
get. Yeah, sure. Is there a question?
Following that, the two conditions, Guillain-Barré syndrome and optic neuritis, are classics for being recognized as something wrong in general practice, and then a firm diagnosis being made later in hospital. What I wonder about is, how do you translate the read codes into the diagnosis that you're looking for?
So,
for instance, you might easily find that optic neuritis would be either described as blindness in a GP record, or severe acute visual impairment, or something like that.
So there is like further information that is relevant for these discussions. To start with, this is only admissions data in patients. The outpatient data, even though there are some data available, it's not really good to use for research purposes. So optic neuritis usually is diagnosed in the outpatient setting. Of course, some of them might be just diagnosed after an admission. Yeah, that's one aspect of it. So even using HAS, inpatient data is limited in the sense that we will not capture all of them. As to the codes used, so I've developed two levels of specificity in my code list to evaluate this issue of imperfect validity. And for this analysis, I've only included in this cohort the ones that didn't have a previous diagnosis in CPRD. So if a person had Guillain-Barré syndrome in CPRD first and after in HAS, in hospital data, I've excluded from this analysis. Because again, as I mentioned, for the real time, I will have that data there. So I'm more interested in those that were not there to start with. But yes, there are some that might have been coded as really, with really vague codes, like with symptom codes instead of an actual diagnosis, that have been missed. And that analysis would be particularly relevant if we were assessing delays in making the diagnosis. Because, of course, there are like certain symptoms that might be suggestive of a condition, and perhaps that's like the initial, and it should be the dates we were looking at. But at the moment, we consider codes that indicate more concrete diagnosis. Does that address your question?
Partially. I'm intrigued, though, that the two where I think the diagnosis would be made would be suspected early, but confirmed later, Guillain-Barré syndrome and optic neuritis, have a different shaped curve.
Yeah, but so
they're a much slower, much softer curve than the two where, I mean, it's easy to diagnose a seizure, and I think it's easy to diagnose Bell's palsy, as you say. So you're bound to get a clear diagnosis early on.
It's not only whether it's easy or not to have a diagnosis, but also whether the GPs will receive information on that particular diagnosis later on,
okay.
And if they receive, whether they will code it. Because, so GPs receive letters, and they have the letters scanned in their system, but we cannot access that data, that information. We can't do any sort of text mining or whatever. We don't have that sort of access. So not only they need to receive that information, as they also need to code it into read codes that we use. So this is definitely a limitation of using CPRD data for research. So in general, this analysis showed that most records accrue within the first month. Of course, other records will have longer delay. And the delays, the pattern, are condition specific, which we need to take into account then when we are to implement. We've seen that there are some limitations of system dates, but also of event dates, because GPs might just put the date at which the symptoms have started, the date they received the letter, so this information is itself limited. And that the issue of low sensitivity, which might be due to information being just there in scan letters, which we can see is there, but we can't use for research. So with these results, we've seen that CPRD is population-based, so it meets that criteria. We've seen there's, from the information published, there's a reasonable validity for these outcomes, and the delay. There are some delay, of course, but we consider it to still be compatible with near real-time surveillance. So now for the power calculations to see whether we have enough size and to mimic a system, we still need to decide which pairs we are going to look at. And of course, knowing that I've only assessed for four specific outcomes that are already limited to the scope. So, Guillain-Barré syndrome in seasonal influenza is one of the pairs that has been studied using these methods. And as I've mentioned from the systematic review, we've seen that seasonal influenza has been studied quite often with these methods due to its characteristics. And Guillain-Barré syndrome being an event of interest for seasonal influenza, this was a pair that I desire to include in the more detailed analysis and the public calculations. Knowing that there's already a signal with a vaccine for MMR and seizures, we've considered that to be a good example to try to replicate that signal using these methods. So I'll be using that as a positive control. And Bexsero, a new meningococcal B vaccine that was introduced last year in the UK, and seizures was decided to be a good example of an application to a new vaccine. So these are basically the pairs I'll be looking at. I've only started the calculations for the first one. So these are really the preliminary results I have to show you. So these are really brand new results that I've been generating in the last few weeks. So when we decide to implement the system, there's, as I've mentioned, a final criteria that we need to see whether CPRD meets or not, which is power. But there's a lot of other questions we also need to get an handle. Namely, which test is better suited to implement near real-time surveillance, and do we need to adapt something in these methods to implement in CPRD? The CPRD needs to change something so we can use them? And so these are the overall questions I'll try to answer with this last step of my work. So in terms of power, we know that this depends on a number of factors, namely the tests that we use. There are tests that can have more power to identify signals and others. The relative risk to be detected. So if there is a really big increase in risk, of course, that's easier to see. There's only a really tiny small increase in risk. Then how often the outcome happens, the risk period, the risk window after the vaccine, the vaccine uptake, meaning how many people are actually receiving the vaccine, and the study period. So these four can actually be integrated in the expected number of events if we calculate, if we use a Poisson type test, calculate comparing the observed number of events with the expected number of events. So as I mentioned, overall for this last piece of work, I'll be evaluating the feasibility of implementing using mimicking a near real-time system with historical data. So for the seasonal influenza and Guillain-Barré syndrome, the first pair that I am looking at, we know that Guillain-Barré syndrome is a rare outcome, so we anticipate quite a small number of events. And I didn't go into a lot of details, but from the tests available, Poisson-based tests involving an observed to expected comparison are considered to be the ones to use it under these circumstances. For this, to mimic this system, I'm using two study seasons, 13-14 and 14-15, and the five previous seasons to each one of these as the historical seasons. For using the historical data, I've calculated age and sex adjusted rates of Guillain-Barré syndrome, and as in the analysis of delays, and the important thing here is that we are consistent when we are implementing both for the historical and the study seasons. I've excluded recording delays over 365 days, so 1 year, and also those that were likely to happen involving mass transfers. I've identified vaccinated individuals using an algorithm based on information from several of the files we received from CPRD, and then based on that historical season and knowing how many vaccinated people I had in the study seasons, I calculated an expected number of events that were adjusted for age and sex distribution. So just for you to get an idea, again, this is very much similar to what I showed you in the key dates, CPRD. To calculate the rates in the historical season, so this one, I've considered all the time throughout a season. So if there was an active patient contributing data during this period, that person was included in the denominator. Of course, the numerator would be the number of cases of pediatrics. For the study season, because this period we've considered is 42 days. So basically, if there is a risk of developing Guillain-Barré syndrome, we consider it to be within the 42 days after the vaccine. This is just the time we consider for the denominator, like the time worth of data we have for each patient. Going back to the issue of data accrual lags, so to delays in receiving data, we've seen that data, we have different types of delays, and I've assessed delays due to data recording. However, we will also be limited in terms of the data being available. So considering that, and because I want to know not only whether CPRD in its current shape is good enough to implement near real-time methods, but also what changes would be required to make it a good data source, I'm building different scenarios that gives us a sense of, okay, we can't really do near real-time surveillance because the data is really delayed and we don't have enough power, but what if the data was not delayed? Would we have enough power then? So, considering that, I've done this analysis assuming no delays. So just looking at the event date as if the data was there for us to analyze straight away. Then considering only delays due to data unavailability, so taking into account the last collection date and then using only the event date, then considering events recorded only within the risk window, so those that happened within the risk window, but also those that were recorded shortly after the vaccine. And finally, using that distribution I showed you before to adjust for delays. So one of the issues with using delay data is that we can get biased results because the more recent data will have less information than the historical data. If we don't take into account delays, then it will seem that we expected more results that we could actually see because we don't have the complete data yet. So it's important to adjust for delays, and this was another scenario. And all these analyses were conducted using sequential, a package developed in R to use this kind of method. So this diagram summarizes the adjustment for data accrual, basically considering the midpoint of the risk window and the possible time we had for data to accrue, and considering the distribution of delays that I previously generated. And these are the initial and the only results I have in terms of power calculations. So this uses a continuous Poisson test, and we have data from both seasons, study seasons, and also considering different scenarios. And in green, you have those that have over 80% of power. So what we see from these is that we will not be able to identify a small increase in relative risk. We don't have enough data to identify that sort of risk. So we would have like less than 20% of power to detect an increased risk of 1.5. However, and the good news are that it seems that we'll be able to identify quite big increases in risk. And in the next weeks and months, I'll be evaluating these in more details, trying to optimize the tasks that I'm going to use, at what time will we be able to identify it, will it be throughout the season, like in the middle of the season, or more towards the end of the season when it would no longer be that useful. But overall, the results so far are quite encouraging, and it does seem that we can benefit from using CPRD data to perform near real-time surveillance. So the next steps, as I mentioned, will be further work looking at this pair, but also looking at the other pairs. Initially, we've planned to compare these methods with other methods that can be assessing in real time, namely social media data, to see how quickly we can actually get a signal from these different methods. However, the analysis of delays took way longer than anticipated, so will not have time. Let's see, or maybe after I finish my PhD, who knows. But it's definitely something I really like to do, to see how these methods compare, how quickly can we identify a signal from different methods. So in summary, we've seen that near real time is an option to quickly identify vaccine safety signals, and it's been increasingly used in a number of countries, but a limited number of countries, mainly in the US. We require timely and readily available data, and with the results so far, CPRD does seem a data source to consider when trying to implement these methods. Before I finish, I'd like to thank my supervisors, and also Stephen Evans from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, and Phil Ryan from the NHRA, and to the NIHR, which is funding my PhD. Thank you very much for your attention.
I'm wondering, in the US, in regards to the electronic healthcare record, is that predominantly from the HMOs or the public sector or teaching hospitals? Where is that data coming from?
So I know there are many administrative claims, but I think from health maintenance organizations.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was wondering where it was.
Yeah,
from.
So these centers contribute data to vaccine safety data link, and they've been doing a lot of work on getting these data as quickly as possible, namely for the pandemic flu season. There was really a lot of work, not only for vaccine safety data link, but also for other healthcare data providers. And it's important to consider that data is a bit different from the data we have, especially if it's administrative claims. This is data that is used for billing. So it's more like justifying the requests made, while here it's primary healthcare data. I'm not saying it's better or worse, it's just different, and we need to take that into account when we analyze it.
I like what you're doing, this sort of very careful evaluation of the methodology before. But there's one last comment that you made that disturbed me. You said you were going to compare this as a single generation with the social media. I mean, a signal you get from social media will be very different from this, and I guess it takes us back to the issue of whether this is actually, well, it's signaling and signal strengthening in one go versus something you get from social media, which would be far from
that. Yeah, that's definitely an issue. I probably wouldn't be able to anyway. But yeah, the idea was more to see in terms of timeliness how these two would compare. But of course, that issue of what type of signal we are actually getting and how noisy is that signal.
I wouldn't think it's worth doing, because they're so different that I think it'll just be confusing, frankly. I don't know what you think.
I think the problem with social media is it's a research field in its own right, which is quite early stages, so it's not a good comparison, because we haven't yet figured out how to do it. It would be more interesting, I think, to compare to the spontaneous reporting system as a baseline. I mean, that is what we use for today.
So in the UK, these methods have been used, implemented using the sort of hybrid approach. So the MHRA has used CPRD to calculate the expected number of events, and then they've used spontaneous reports to calculate the number of the observed number of events. So the idea was actually to compare the trio of five. But I don't think I'll have time to compare either of them. Because as I mentioned, the delays, which they were supposed to be a really small intermediate step just to have a go for the actual implementation, but I've been analyzing delays since like October last year until June this year. So it took me really a long time, and the issue with system dates, which are really important for what I'm doing. So I think it's actually preferable to keep it under the near real time.
I think it's a good choice. I think you've done a very careful job, and I think it's very good. I mean, bring lots of value to do that better than try to do too much.
Yeah.
So I think this is really interesting with the sensitivity as well to see. I mean, we've seen this indirectly looking at PIM data and IMS data, which is similar to the CPRD. Just lots of diagnoses are not captured well enough. So to do that at that level of detail, I think, is really valuable.
And I do think the definition is of these various syndromes, like Guillain-Barré, is very, very important, because it does occur over a period of time. So there's bound to be a delay, which is different from something that's simple, like Bell's palsy, which you wake up one day and you've got it.
yeah, that is definitely the issue of the onset. Like, even though we consider the Guillain-Barré syndrome to be acute, there is definitely some sort of really vague symptoms that start, and then they are initially not diagnosed. But as I've mentioned, I've used a more sensitive and a more specific published and compared that. And in fact, the delays were quite similar. There were some differences, but they were quite similar, which was reassuring for me.
It's very important. I've just been looking at an old colleague's paper on Guillain-Barré syndrome. He had 13 cases, but three of those at least sort of didn't quite fit a standard definition, and you wonder what to do with those. And
so,
you know, when you think you've time to onset, it's a problem.
So this will be an important discussion point for me, but I don't think I'll have time as part of my PhD to go into details as to how to handle a signal if we detect one from this sort of surveillance. But in the US, in vaccine safety data link, they've done a lot of work, so they already have sort of a standardized approach. And one of the things they do in some places is to validate the cases they get. So they actually then go back and have access to information to see if there's actually, using standard definition, whether there's actually a case and whether it changes or not the results of the analysis. Using CPRD, I don't think that would be possible, because it's quite hard nowadays. There's a lot of issues with confidentiality, and it became harder to get access to data. So one of the changes in policy they have was no longer making the free text available. So we have fields where there's free text, and we can see we have a note saying there's free text, but we can see what text is in there. And before, we could ask for that free text, but we just have